Hi, I am journalist Annie Dance. Please subscribe to Cops in Congress, anniedance.substack.com. I am working to shine a light on police and policy issues in Lake Lure, Western North Carolina, and beyond. If you follow state politics at all, which of course I do, by interest and by my job as a journalist, it's very interesting in North Carolina that a lot of what happens is not archived. And I mean that in the sense of the video archive of legislative sessions in committees is streamed. However, there's not an archive piece to that. It's unclear exactly why that is, but my guess is that it's probably cost prohibitive. If that's something that lawmakers have discussed in the past, I am not exactly clear on why the powers that be decided that. However, they do stream their meetings. So I'm about to share a stream meeting from today's House Select Committee on Education Reform that is currently already underway. So when you go to nclege.gov and you click on the stream link, you can see them live. However, if someone's not available to watch it live, then basically you're out of luck unless a journalist records it. Stay tuned. Here we go. This is already underway, so it's going to catch up. But there are additional documents, I will say, to be fair, on the state's website, nclege.gov.
Did not have that same requirement. So yes, military support is also provided for our military students via their school counselor.
Thank you, Representative Biggs. I appreciate you guys coming out. I'm representing the class after 1990, graduated. Got a few of us out here. I kept on hearing the pre-1990. But, you know, appreciate you guys. Had two kids just graduate high school not too recently, and long ago, and just appreciate what you do as far as just the scholarships and helping them get on track and the college applications and everything like that. It's just amazing. And I guess my question is, you know, the optimal caseload here is 250 to one, and I just know just in my LEA that that's not the case. Are we having trouble filling these jobs? I got a couple of questions because our counselors are great, but it just amazed me that they took all the students because, you know, I felt like, and I'm sure all the other parents felt like it was just like they were just our kids' counselor, right? They were really doing a great job, and that's what you want to feel, that personal touch. But are you seeing, I see what's optimal here. Are you seeing LEs take advantage of that? Or is it a problem just in the hiring, like the rest of the school system that we're having right now?
No, we're not having issues in hiring. Of course, we'd like to have more school counselors so that we can, as you're hearing the job duties with it, looking at career, social emotional, college, there's, you know, some many tasks. So we're looking to have more so that we can continue to bring the ratios down to get close as we can to the nationally recognized ratio that they're recommending of 1 to 250. So if we have more positions, we can definitely get those filled and would like to.
Follow up, Representative Biggs. So, and to go to Representative, going to college, some of them's going to community college, the universities and all that. Would it be optimal, use y'all's word, to start getting like more classifications where, like Representative Shepherd said, if they really got something they just need to talk about, they have that counselor just there for that? Because the caseload to me seems like if you're pulled in 20 different directions, which are doing a great job, it's amazing that they can do it. Would it be more optimal to have more specific, you know, lanes to stay in? Or have y'all looked at that?
So this is something I looked at a lot in my last year of school counselors serving 100% of students, and that if we had more funding for school counseling specific and getting our ratios down, at some point it seems smarter to maybe work upstream, right? So if we're having a lot of these anxiety issues and a lot more coming through our caseload, we have to look further up to see what's actually happening, right? And school counselors work a lot in prevention. So teaching those classroom lessons about coping skills, right? Stress management, self-control, self-management. Those also include, you know, college and career skills and stuff like that, how to, those soft skills that you hear about, right? And so if we were able to do more proactive things with more school counselors, that is kind of the argument, is that we would see less getting in those tier three areas. That is the hope, at least, right? And I think a lot of us have kind of re-upped some of our certification as far as like, or just continuing education on mental health. But I think that, you know, the ratios as far as having to do other duties outside of all the preventative stuff that we do can be really difficult with the ratios that we have. Obviously, we make it work every day because we're school counselors, right? But I think that is why our ratio ask has been there for a while for more funding specifically for school counselors in a building. And yeah, so that we can work upstream a little bit instead of being completely reactive to everything that happens.
All right, Representative Blackwell, then we're going to go to Representative Jackson and then to Representative Warren. Representative Blackwell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I have several questions. I would like to begin by saying I'm not going to indicate whether I graduated before 1990. If anybody thinks that I did not, I'm willing to go with that.
Can I just ask you one brief question relative to that?
You don't have the floor, do you? I guess you're the chair, so you can.
Did they have the wheel when you went to school?
Help me understand better. What is the difference between a school counselor, a school psychologist, and a psychologist that works in the school? Because it sounds to me like everybody's dealing with the same stuff to a large degree, even though each group may have particular items that they are uniquely dealing with.
Go ahead.
Am I able to go back to the slides or no? Is that okay? Sorry. Okay. So I just sort of defined them there a little bit here. School psychologist is doing more like targeted academic and behavioral health testing towards those, what we call like tier three students, right? So students who have been identified who might need evaluation or identification of like intensive learning, special education services. Counselors are doing that for like the greater population and more of like a teaching and preventative role of that. And so school psychologists are a little more specific in who they work with. And a lot of that, you know, they could do a lot more if they had less numbers as well, but they do a lot more with specific testing, whereas we are working more towards the comprehensive whole child for all students. Anything y'all would want to add?
Right. I just wanted to add on to that, given the difference with the school counselors versus the other three, all of them are needed and definitely appreciated in a school, and we have to collaborate. But with the school counselors, you find we're working with 100%, you know, of the students every day, because it may be like now a lot of our schools are involved in registration and working with students to plan schedules that'll help them to get to whatever their post-secondary goals are. We may be, you know, dealing with something that's socially emotional and helping them through a crisis, and all at the same time, if you will, having to keep up with that accountability towards the students that come every day. So whereas some of the others, it may be we make, you know, a referral for a service that is needed with school counselors. We're there every day. We're walking the halls with those students. We're involved in their activities helping them to be successful. So 100% of the time, it's not just specific groups that may have an attendance issue or may need testing. We're working with those students at where we find them and trying to help them to get to that next level of success, whatever that means for that student. So it's individualized, it's purposeful, and sometimes it could be a group, but we're there and need it every day. So that's a little bit of the difference there.
But there's been an interest expressed here in the mental health aspect, which you all indicate you deal with, but what's the social worker doing, and why wouldn't it be more efficient to refer mental health issues pretty much straight on to somebody who's got more training and preparation in that program?
Sure. So if you want to think of the graphic that you see in terms of an upside down pyramid, I'll take it that way because I too am visual. So if you look at an upside down pyramid or upside down triangle, school counselors are across the top. We work with every student in that building at any time, every single day, Monday through Friday. So we're there every single day. Your school social workers, your school psychologists, and your school nurses are in and out of the building. They're not based at a school Monday through Friday from the first bell to the second bell. And the school psychologists, the school nurse, and the school social workers work with a smaller population of the 100% of students because they work in specialized areas. For example, your school social workers are going to work with families who are in need of community resources, other resources outside of the school, providing school supplies, things like that. So they're going to work with that portion of the population that have higher needs than the 100%. Your school nurses are going to work with students who have medical plans or who have medical issues, who need medical plans at school. So as school employees, we get trained every year on EpiPens. If we have students in our building who have medical needs, we get trained on how to apply or supply the medicine and so forth as well. So school nurses work with the smaller population. They work with the students who have medical needs. School psychologists work with the students who are referred to them who are needing educational testing to see if they are in need of specialized instruction, such as special education services, which a lot of people know as the IEP, or if students need a 504 plan, they will provide educational testing for that. So they work with the small population as well. So school counselors, we're the whole school because we're there every day, all day, Monday through Friday with every student. School social workers, nurses, and psychologists help support that by doing their specialized areas. Does that help answer your question?
Yes, thank you. Second question, Mr. Chairman. I want to also ask about continuing ed that school counselors go through. Can you help me understand? My assumption is that you all have a certain number of hours of continuing ed that you're required to do every so often. But my question beyond that is it completely up to the counselor in each instance as to what type of coursework, I'll say, they take for the continuing ed? Or are you all required to take continuing ed of certain types? And let me tell you a couple of points of interest of mine. You mentioned that you use data. It's my impression that a lot of school personnel that use data didn't get trained in the use and interpretation of data when they were in school, education schools, so that the only place they're going to get it is on the job or through continuing ed. Secondly, I don't know how many of you in education school were trained in dealing with students who can't read comprehensively. That's a big problem, in my opinion, for sixth grade and up. After they get out of the elementary school, we don't have teachers that seem to be focused on reading. And so I'm wondering to what extent in your continuing ed, you all are dealing with both recognizing the need and trying to help deal with that. Another area we hear about, or I have, I think, is that guidance counselors, now school counselors, are not seemingly prepared to deal as effectively in today's modern employment market with career counseling and credentials as opposed to associate degrees and four-year degrees at college, which were the more traditional higher ed. And I'm just wondering to what extent it's up to each counselor. Well, do I want to take that and learn more about data or reading or career? Or does somebody say you got to do this because this is the new thing and everybody needs to know it?
Thank you. And I'll do my best to get all of those points. One of the things that some things are specified by the district. I know in the district where I serve, there are certain trainings that are specified. Some of that has to do with it may be human trafficking, which is a huge issue. That we want all of our counselors to have that. It may be how to do a child protective services referral. That is specified, and everybody has to do that and do it on a regular basis, not just within 5 years. Different levels. We also have curriculum that we're pushing out into classes, and counselors have to be trained on. One of the ones that we use is called Second Step, so that we can do social emotional learning and training throughout our school to reach all of our students in the classroom and work in conjunction with teachers. You're talking about a student who may have a literacy issue. One of the things that school counselors would do is convening parent-teacher conferences so that we can also look with the professionals that are also mentioned there so that we can come up with a plan that can help move that student forward. When something is noticed, normally that referral would come into a school counselor, and then we're able to sit down and try to make a plan for success, trying different interventions and things to make sure that we can get support for that student to be successful. So there are lots of different things that school counselors have to do outside of what is required for them to have their license renewed. And that is specified by the district and where they work. So we're trained on, working with all types of issues. We work with other people in the district that we have a family that may come in and they may be presenting as homeless. We have to be able to do that. So there's a whole list of things that counselors have to learn within their district. We also do different orientations each year for new counselors to make sure that if something may have been missed in their training that they had at the graduate level, that that's there. In all of the graduate programs that I'm aware of, they also do career counseling and training. And some schools have career counselors that they work with, but majority of all school counselors are also trained to handle career questions and issues. We work with various career development programs in our districts throughout the state to make sure that students have a career development plan in place, and the school counselors are working and making sure that students have that as well. So school counselors are learning all the time. As I mentioned today, we were meeting to hear about how to best deal with attendance coming out of COVID still. Making sure we're getting students re-engaged in school, and part of that is making sure that they have plans, whether they're going directly into the world of work, into a career, working with a community college to make sure that they can get a part of an apprenticeship program or something, making sure that all those students know that they matter and that we are on the front lines with them to make sure that they have a plan when they graduate so that they're not only just graduating, that they're graduating with an option and prepared to have the skills, both those hard skills and soft skills to be able to go out and do the work or be able to be successful with rigor at the higher education level. Anyone want to add?
Representative Jackson.
Oh, thank you, sir. I just want to say to you all, thank you for what you do. Instruction could not happen in the classroom. I am a classroom educator. And to Representative Shepherd, we call them. They don't really have to call us. We call on them in the classroom. But also, they go around to each of the classes and tell them what they're able to do for them. So I just want to thank you all for what you do. We met Representative Wheatley and I met with our school district, about 2 weeks ago. And in the budget request that's coming in 2025, they're making us aware that they do need more of all of those individuals at what ratio they need them. Because at my school, we have over 600 sixth graders and we have one counselor. So we know that there's a greater need. So I just want to say thank you for what you do.
Representative Warren.
Thank you. I'm going to have to modify my question based on what you've just been answering. The News and Observer has a story that just today, I believe, that there's an increase in homelessness in students in Wake County. And I just wondered, my original question was going to be, do you interact with that? But from your description, and I apologize, I don't remember your name. No, you. Okay, you. From your description, it sounds like the school counselors are basically triage for the student body as a whole.
Yes.
When you are introduced to a challenge that a student has, you then refer that student to someone more precisely or trained for that specific issue that child has. But my question is, have you, in your capacity, do you interact with the kids that
might
present as being homeless?
Yes, sir. I am the McKinney-Vento contact, and that's what our district calls us. McKinney-Vento is the federal law that is the umbrella for students who are what the term now is housing insecure, which was formerly called homeless. So yes, as school counselors, we do engage with students who present as homeless without housing. The student can appear by him or herself alone. They can show up, say that they're homeless, and it is a federal law, so all school counselors are trained in that and get retrained every year, but we enroll them in school and get them in classrooms that exact day. If a family presents as homeless, we definitely enroll that student, connect them with services, get that student set up as well. Within your district, you work with your district's transportation office to provide transportation, because the term went from homeless to housing instability, because homeless just doesn't. The connotation we often have are the people we see under bridges in tents. But homeless also looks like you're living in a household with three other families, whether they're neighbors of yours, friends of yours, or family of yours. Homeless also looks like you're living in a shelter in your city or town. But homeless also looks like you're living in hotels where you're paying night by night to see if you can come up with the money that day for tonight's stay in the hotel. So homeless looks different. Housing insecurity, families often move frequently. So instead of being homeless, it's housing insecure. We know that students will more than likely move a couple of times within that school year. So yes, sir, we do work with those students to make sure they're getting to school on time, that they have meals while they're at school, breakfast and lunch is provided for them, and making sure that they have that connection to education. Because as anyone who's had anyone in your family or circle who's in crisis, you look for stability. And for students in crisis, school is stability. So we want to make sure that students who are facing housing insecurity has the stability of knowing I could get up every day, I have transportation to get to school, I know I'm going to get at least two meals while I'm there, and I'm going to get education as well and interact with peers and adults who care about me. So every school counselor deals with students who have been identified or who present as housing insecure. Yes, sir.
Follow up,
Representative Warren.
I guess just this one follow-up. So is it possible, I'm assuming that the causes for homelessness is probably a combination of broken homes, poor economic conditions at home, or unemployment, or perhaps just the lack of affordable housing. Can you, from your experience, indicate any one of those is more predominant than others?
No. That's not a question we ask the family. In the counseling world, we would consider that a little too personal. And at the time that they present to us, we're there to help them get enrolled in school and get them back into school education. I don't think they do. We don't ask how you ended up homeless. It's not of our concern at that point in time. We're trying to re-engage our student into school and continue education with the hopes that once we get them back re-engaged and on a path of being successful in education, they can then help their family once they graduate, no matter what the situation.
If I could pose another question.
Yeah.
We'll call this an addendum to your follow-up.
This is a continuation of my last question. The reason I ask is that we hear try to address all those issues.
Yes.
And to better invest in the area that would help break that chain, it's important to know the causes, rather than just to react to the causes and try to alleviate some of the aftermath of the cause.
Yes.
It would be helpful to know
yes
what what the cause is, what we can address. Is there anywhere along that line that someone's gathering that information?
Not at from education. High school level.
If you have a district coordinator that we would keep up with that data, but at the school level, the school counselor is there, as Ms. Sharp said, to make sure that that student is getting in, connected with the school and matriculating successfully. And so that's not, you know, data that we would have at the school level.
And we appreciate everything you do. Thank you so much for being here today.
And I wanted to mention one last thing that you had mentioned about the data and people being trained. We do have that in place throughout the district as well when we're having people to develop and organize their comprehensive counseling programs, because that would involve looking at the data to make sure if there's any group of students that may not be performing at a level that would have them to have success, that we look at that and see what programs or other things that we could put in place to answer those needs. So school counselors are trained in that on a regular basis.
Go ahead, Representative Black.
One quick follow-up on that with reference to reading. Do you mean that you all look at the data about reading for the students in your school and you would maybe call in a student to deal with them over that issue? Or do you wait for the teacher to identify the student as having the issue and then you deal with it when it's referred? Or maybe it happens both ways?
Yeah, so I think it's a both and. I've had it both directions. I definitely think that, you know, we are a part of the team that does that, because oftentimes reading deficiencies or any type of learning deficiency can cause behaviors, right? And so sometimes we are asked to support it that way. But yes, it can go either way. And a lot of us are sitting on like boards and different chairing different positions or different committees to look at student academic success and how we can be a part of, you know, helping the solution with that, whether it's like helping them get into groups for different skills, supporting different, you know, coping skills when things are hard, work is hard, right? How do we stay engaged and keep learning? But it can definitely go, it doesn't always happen one direction, right? It's kind of a collaborative pool of in which way that it might happen at different times. Yeah.
Representative Cervania.
Thank you, Chair. I wanted to thank you all for your presentation, especially Ms. Sharp, because I came from your space supporting all of you for a few years. Reinforce this for me. I think you did reinforce it through your presentation that you are only limited to the scope of what your position is. As Representative Warren said, it seems as though you all are the triage, and then you refer out to be specific on the needs of the child, be it wraparound services from the social worker, a physical health situation with the nurse, and testing solely from the school psychologist, correct?
Yes, and depending on the school psychologist you have at your school, if there's not a lot of testing going on, they will work collaboratively with us as school counselors to help assist as well with meeting with students. Okay. Yes, that is correct.
Follow up,
Chair. Representative Cervania.
So many of us here have expressed the need for actual psychologists or psychiatric care for our students. And I think maybe there's a misconception that school psychologist provides that service, but it does not, correct? So my last question is, when we're provided data, the ratios that are needed when it comes to those three areas, I think we need to also get ratios when it comes to actual psychologists who can address the mental health needs of our students too. And is that available? And what is that number? And if you don't have it, that's fine. It would be good to receive that.
With the role of the school psychologist, they're not trained in that I'm sorry.
Correct. That, and I'm saying a psychologist, not a testing school psychologist.
Oh, okay.
Actually, someone who can, and we were talking about it earlier here, if we want to tackle student mental health, we need to know what position that is in a school and how many we also need, like a pure child psychologist to address student mental health.
We don't have that number, sorry. A child psychologist is different from a school psychologist. And so the child psychologist works in the community. You think of after school or evening and programs and things like that. We don't have that number of their ratio or things like that.
Chair, may I just clarify that? So maybe it's the number of referrals that you all provide, so we have a better knowledge of what the need is when it comes to psychological or psychiatric services for the students. Because we can't address mental health needs for our children if we don't know, right, that number.
Yeah, I definitely think that's something that we as NCSCA could gather together throughout different districts and send to you of different referrals. I know at Alamance Burlington, we use school counselor use of time analysis, so we're able to see the referrals that then got referred to mental health services, but we could definitely get that number for you. It like a ballpark, right? Probably not. Nothing is exact, but it's as close as we could get it from different districts for an average. Yeah.
Okay, any additional questions? Well, Vanessa, Meredith, Natarcia. Oops, sorry. Representative Blackwell.
This question is Representative Servania's fault because she made me think of this. While you all are getting us some additional information, I know you cited the desired ratio for staffing. Can you all provide us, not now, but later, with some data that would indicate that in districts across the nation, where they have the higher staffing patterns, that there are better outcomes for students as compared to the ones with the lower staffing ratio or higher? Well, you know what I mean.
Ladies, thank you for explaining in depth your added responsibilities and how they seem to continue to add. We deeply appreciate from a heartfelt on behalf of the committee. Thank you for the work that you provide the students of North Carolina. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Our next presentation from North Carolina Association of School Administrators Revising Principal Pay is Dr. John Lassiter, Hertford Grammar School. Is it the Hertford? It's a steer, right? That's what your dad used to raise, I think, wasn't it? Yeah. Hertford Grammar School, Perquimans County Schools, and Ashley Falkenberry, Trent Park Elementary, Craven County Schools. Now, Perquimans, would that be one of the finger counties they call it?
Yeah, we're in the big section of the northeastern part of the.
I know it and love it very much. Thank y'all. Thank y'all for being here. And whoever would like to go first, you have the podium.
Thank you, Chairman Torbett and Co-Chair Biggs, for having the rest of the committee for having us today. My name is Ashley Falkenberry, and I am from Craven County Schools, as he mentioned. I am serving you as the 13 years as the principal at Trent Park Elementary School, and I've also served at the elementary and middle school levels. And today I come to you as the 2023 Southeast Regional Principal of the Year. And now I'm going to turn it over to Dr. John Lassiter to introduce himself.
Congratulations, by the way.
Good afternoon. My name is Dr. John Lassiter. I'm excited to be here today. I am also part of the 2003 Wells Fargo cohort of Principals of the Year from the Northeast, again, Perquimans County.
Congratulations also.
Thank you very much. So we're excited to be here to represent our colleagues and to tell you some ideas that we have that can support the great work that you guys did in 2018 to increase principal pay around the state. So we are giving you a handout because throughout our presentation, we want you to be able to compare the current principal compensation plan to the one that we're proposing today. We want to make that easy on you by having that presentation. So we're here today because we recognize that there's a sense of urgency to support North Carolina schools and to ensure strong school leadership is in place, because we know that school leadership is one of the top two leading factors impacting overall school success. And we recognize that education is at a crossroads, and they want to promote the importance of having a good school leader in each school. You know, school leaders are leaving the profession, and we think that there are small small tweaks to the principal compensation plan that can support keeping great school leaders in the schools, specifically in the role of a principal. So as we get started, we want to say thank you. We recognize that in 2016, there was a joint legislative committee that looked at principal pay. At that time, North Carolina was ranked near the bottom. I think it was 50th. And this committee worked hard to make sure that principal compensation was addressed in a meaningful way. Today, we want to look at adding a few complexity factors to the principal compensation plan that look at the challenging job that a principal has in a more unique way. But before we start sharing what those complexities might be, we wanted to highlight and say thank you, because we know that this work's ongoing. We know that it's not something that can be done in 1 year, and we want to recognize the incredible investment that the General Assembly made back in 2018. So this is a screenshot of the current principal compensation plan. If you look, there are two factors that impact a principal's pay in the state. The first one is on the far left, and is the average daily membership of your school. So how many students go to your school? And it's broken down into tiers, up to 200 students, between 200 and 400, and it goes down as you go down the salary schedule. But in looking into this principal compensation plan, we recognized that 75% of the schools in our state are in the top three rows of that principal compensation plan. Less than 25% of the principals are paid in the bottom three rows, and very few principals serve schools that are over 1,600 students and even have an opportunity to meet the bottom right-hand corner of the current principal compensation plan. To my knowledge, principals are the only category of employee that is paid by the taxpayer that is judged on their performance, and move across from base pay to meeting growth to exceeding growth based on student achievement. Now, we're not here today to suggest that that go away. We think that principals, as the research says, do impact student achievement. And we recognize that principals have a big impact on the learning that takes place in their school. But we want to talk about solutions that we think can offset some of the big pay gaps when sometimes principals run into concerns that are beyond their control. Throughout this presentation, we will share a couple of stories that kind of outline what are those events that may be outside the principal's control, just so that you understand why we're making the ask that we are today. So the current principal compensation plan was a huge step in the right direction. We recognized the effort and the investment that you guys made, the General Assembly made, in 2018. But with any new legislation, sometimes there's some unintended consequences that can be revisited. And those are what drive our proposal today. So we've outlined them in really three key areas. The first one is we want to offset the big swings in pay that may be based on factors that do stretch beyond the principal's control. The second one is the current compensation plan does not consider the complexity of the schools that principals serve around the state. For example, a school of 400 students in Pequimas County might look very different than a school of 400 students in Wake County or in a county in the western part of the state. So we want to start looking at the complexities of different schools around the state. The third, and I think it's a key initiative, is that the current plan does de-incentivize outstanding assistant principals from moving into the profession as a principal and to lead their own school and then to stay in the field if they're a successful principal. And we hope to outline why that's the case as we go through the presentation. today. So that throughout the survey, or throughout the presentation, you'll see a couple survey questions. We worked with NC PAPA to send this survey out to hear from the principals in the field. We've had over 1,000 respondents in the last 30 days. And as we go through the presentation, we're going to share four of the questions so that you kind of see what the principals that are working in the field would say about the principal compensation plan and then their support of the proposed compensation plan for today. So with this survey question, only 21%, so about 1 in 5 of principals surveyed, agree or strongly agree that performance-based pay is currently makes up a fair portion of their salary. Again, we don't recommend removing performance pay from principal compensation. We know that it's an important part of the work that we do. But we do want to share that the majority of the principals think that it's not a fair portion of how they're compensated. So opportunities for improvement. The challenges that this proposal hopes to overcome is to look at three areas. First, reducing the swings in salary. If you look across the salary schedule at the highest level, some principals could lose up to $18,000 in a year if their student growth falters, again, sometimes based on conditions that are out of their control. The second one is recognizing that not all schools are the same, looking at not just the average daily membership, but also school complexities that impact schools. And then lastly, we want to suggest a way to promote principal retention. Adding a retention supplement can offset a principal's desire to leave a school and move to central office. And there are plenty of outstanding principals. In fact, I took over for a principal who left the school and moved into a central office position. So next, I'm not going to spend a lot of time on the proposal now. We'll come back to it at the end, but we want to share how we got to from where we are to where we want to go for the proposal we have today. But as we outline the minor tweaks to the current proposal, we want you to know that this is a proposal that is supported across the state. We've worked hard to maintain and build off the proposal that was in place, because we tried to make the proposals very symmetrical. As you move from one to the other, it's clear to see how they're the same, but then the small tweaks that we think would improve principal compensation around the state. We're not here asking for a significant pay increase. We're asking to redeploy some of the resources so that there's more stability in pay. Again, we do not want to move forward without recognizing the voice of the principals that were part of the survey and honoring the work that they do for the students of North Carolina. And now I'll turn it over to Ashley.
Thank you, John. And John just gave you a first look at the proposal. And now I am going to walk you through the features of the proposed plan over the next few slides. So first, we want to establish a complexity model that considers more than just school size or that average daily membership mentioned before. We want to create a plan that links all school employees to one salary scale while ensuring that the principal is the highest paid employee in the building. We want to reduce the performance swings in our pay so that it may stabilize salaries while maintaining the structure currently in place. And finally, we want to propose honoring the incentive structure. We want to propose adding a system of retention based on years as school principal to keep leaders in their school. So not as years in education, but just as a school principal. So let's go through some of these in more detail. So first, we want to acknowledge school complexity. Currently, the only school complexity that's recognized is school size or ADM, average daily membership. I currently work at a school with approximately 400 students, just as John mentioned, and all schools with 400 across the school are not created equal. There are other factors that we would like to recognize here that affect the work that each of us do every day. And these include our academically gifted population, our multi-language learners, our homeless demographic, our economically disadvantaged students, and our EC or exceptional children's population in our schools. So I currently work at a school, like I said, of 400. My school, out of the 400, 120 of those students are considered multi-language learners. They're not only multi-language learners, but they also fall under the refugee demographic. We have 27 different birth nations at my school and 16 different languages. It can be challenging from day to day when a lot of those are dialects that you cannot get on Google Translate. We currently are also 100% free and reduced lunch. And we have about 14% of our exceptional in the exceptional children's program. This is very different than a school that would be considered affluent, where many of the students come in proficient and have no multi-language learners or no students identified in the exceptional children's program. This is a totally different way of doing business. The students that are captured in these circles on the slide require more time and more effort to have their unique needs met. More complex schools equals high stress, higher burnout, more turnover, and less stability for schools. So simply put, more complex schools are more difficult to lead. So on this slide, we're going to talk about how poverty correlates with consistent school growth. Let's look at this bar graph here. This describes the complexity factor of poverty. Our current system ranks growth of all schools with no considerations of this complexity factor or disadvantagement. This graph shows the correlation between socioeconomic status and the school's ability to exceed growth. The green bar shows those students in very low poverty schools, and the red bars show the schools with the highest poverty schools. In the school year 2022-2023, you were nearly five times more likely to exceed growth if you led a school with low poverty than a school with high levels of poverty. That's pretty astounding. Similarly, nearly twice as many schools with high poverty student populations did not meet growth, and that's that 31.8%, as compared to high poverty schools that exceeded growth at 18.8%. This really proves that principals who serve more complex schools have unique challenges to overcome to accomplish similar results to schools located in more affluent areas across the state. So, when listening to the voices of our colleagues here, only 7% agree or strongly agree that the current pay plan encourages high-performing principals to transition to low-performing schools. We need the most effective principals in the highest need schools, instead of the reality right now that most of these schools are being led by newly hired principals. With this new proposed plan, we want to create an incentive for recruitment and retention for the best principals in our state. There's phenomenal assistant principals across the state that they would not receive any pay increase to move to a principal position. These school leaders are the next generation of principals and deserve compensation to incentivize them to want to become building leaders. For instance, our current North Carolina State Principal of the Year, Donna Bledsoe, is the principal at Cedar Ridge Elementary School in Surry County. Her wonderful assistant principal, I have to say, has been in education for nearly two decades. She has her master's degree, and she's a nationally board-certified teacher. For her to benefit moving into a building leader position, she would have to go to lead a very large school, one of those in the bottom rows that John showed you, over 1,000 students. Most first-time principals and their opportunities to be successful, we would normally want to put them in schools with a lower enrollment. The changes we are proposing ensures that the CEO or the principal of the school is the highest paid in the organization and aligns level of compensation with level of accountability. Thankfully, there is a state law that holds principals harmless, because if there was not, there would be numerous cases throughout the state that teachers and assistant principals who were making more, they would be making more than their building supervisor. In fact, if you compare monthly gross pay, a teacher with nationally board certification and a master's degree is able to actually earn more than a newly hired principal that is paid on that and that base pay level. So So again, in hearing our colleagues, less than 15% of principals agree or strongly agree that the current pay plan encourages school leaders to transition into the role of principal. So this survey question proves that most assistant principals are very hesitant to follow the traditional progression and seek this next step in their career. As we look at our next feature, and over the next three slides, you're going to see subjects that impact principal pay versus the ones that do not. This is an elementary example, and only six out of dozens of classes factor into the EVOS for student growth, which could impact a principal's annual salary by up to $18,000 a year. At every level of schooling, there are more subjects that do not impact principal pay than those that do. The yellow column here, and you can see in third and fourth grade, reading and math, and in fifth grade, reading, math, and science. These are the only classes that factor into principal compensation. And as we move to the middle school level and high school levels, that number of courses that do not impact principal pay only increases. So looking at our middle school level here, the blue column again is the ones that impact principal pay, and the courses on the far right are the ones that do not impact principal pay. Again, our sixth and seventh grade is reading and math, and our eighth grade is reading, math, and science. And then as we transition to our high school example, in a building of potentially 50 to 100 staff members, only English 2, Math 1, and Math 3 are included in the current model that impacts principal compensation. There are some schools with 50 plus teachers, and less than 10 of those impact principal compensation. And what if for a year, one of those tested areas was one that was an unfilled vacancy, which we have seen across the state right now, or a teacher that has to go out on maternity leave? This is the story of our 2022 North Carolina Principal of the Year, Dr. Patrick Green. And you can notice in this example that many legislative priorities, such as CTE or the career and technical education and the college and career and college promise courses taken by high school students, are not among those courses that impact a principal's pay. Before we move on to taking a look at retaining principals, note that the current compensation plan for principals only has two factors that are considered now, that these also heavily influence and can negatively impact a principal's pay. Adding the complexities that we spoke about earlier outlined in this plan will strengthen the plan to better honor all the work that the principals actually do. Now I'm going to talk to you about some staggering statistics on principal retention. Here you can see that nationally, 1 in 5 principals leave the profession each year. And in North Carolina, that number is closer to 1 in 4. The problem of retention is greatest at the high poverty schools that were close to 30% of principals leaving their schools. And if 1 in 5 principals leave in the first year, 50% of principals are leaving within the first 3 years hired. As principals become more experienced, research shows that they tend to move to lead these fewer complexity factor schools and ones that serve high income areas and high achieving students. So I'm going to leave this slide up for just a minute so these metrics can sink in. If we do not honor principal experience as part of the new proposal, we fear that the statistics will only become a greater concern across the state, further impacting our education's future workforce. And again, here's a few more statistics on principal retention. What happens to schools when principals leave? Well, student achievement drops in both math and reading in the year following the vacancy, and it can take the next principal up to 3 years or more to gain forward progress for the school. And John mentioned this was actually his story when he came into his school, so I'm going to let him share that story now.
Yeah, I was fortunate to take Hartford Grammar School over from the 2017 North Carolina Principal of the Year, Jason Griffin. The year that he was traveling the state as the North Carolina Principal of the Year, He had about a 30% teacher turnover rate. They knew that there was a transition in administration coming. Once I arrived, we had another year of high turnover, and our school performance grade dropped from a 70 exceeding growth down to a 60, and then the pandemic hit. And it has been 3 years of hard work since that time to where we've now returned back to a 69, 1 point from a B, and we exceeded growth this year. That's a testament to the hard work of the students and staff at Hartford Grammar School. But the point is that it aligns to the research that we're seeing, that it took us 5 years through a pandemic to recover from a 70 school performance grade B back to a 69, 1 point away, exceeding growth both the years because of the turnover. Even though the leadership remained strong, the turnover impacted student achievement.
Can I interrupt? I gotta ask, why? Because I don't understand why that occurred. Can you help me understand why a principal leaving, teachers vacated, and scores dropped?
I can speak to my experience, not from across the state. Mr. Griffin, who I know personally, was moving into a central office opportunity, there was transition in the school, and there was opportunities for teachers to seek a more stable environment. And so many of them moved up a grade level to sixth grade, or in my county, which is a K-2 school and a 3-5 school, moved down to second grade, where they knew that there was going to be stable leadership in the midst of hiring a new principal. Things improved my first year there, and our retention rate's been really strong in the past 3 years, and I attribute that to us getting back to a 69 and exceeding growth this past year.
Can I ask one follow-up question on that? That transition, is that not a transition that occurs each year to some aspect, or is that just a really full-blown transition at that school?
Well, I think it depends on the structure of leadership in the district, but I do think you're going to have natural attrition, like turnover. We have a Coast Guard base near our school, so we have military families that move in and out, and those are beyond our control. But stability in leadership proves to improve teacher retention, and if we improve teacher retention, then we're less likely to see the dip in scores.
And I say that because that just deeply concerns me, because I know where I come from in Gaston, they often change principals each year. Like, I'm not going to say they rotate them, but sometimes it seems like that. And if what you're saying has some, obviously it's factual, but if that has some component built to how our students are performing, and then we have school systems that are just rotating principals, then perhaps we're not coming anywhere near what our full performance could be if we had a more stabilized leader in the school.
Yep. It's difficult to cast a vision. But once you've cast a vision and work with your school improvement team to develop a shared decision-making model, the teachers want to be part of the team that you've created. And if that team changes each year, it's hard to build the culture that causes teachers to want to stay with you.
Right. Everybody wants to win the pennant. So you're going to go with the best coach. Yeah. Yeah.
Amongst your staff, too.
Thank you. Can we let them, I'm sorry, I jumped in, but can we let them finish if, or unless you want to ask right now?
I was going to follow up on what you were talking
about. Go right here.
I'm just curious because, I mean, from what you put up there, it would sound like this is not just an isolated case, but that anytime you do this, that there's going to be a 3-year fallback in regaining. It seems to me that the superintendent and the school board deserve some responsibility for not being aware of this and taking steps to deal with that locally in the schools by reassuring teachers that they're not going to get some bad person in there and that they don't need to go off seeking stability, as you described. Otherwise, I don't know how you ever have stability. Raising the pay may keep somebody a little longer, but they're still going to leave eventually, and then you've got instability and 3 years of catching up again.
Yeah, I do agree that the Board of Education superintendent can mitigate how big those achievement losses are. But the change in leadership is often going to result in a level of turnover. But there are ways to mitigate it. And I think one of those ways is by incentivizing assistant principals to want to become principals. Because if the assistant principal in the school is able to take over and repeat that consistent leadership and carry on in the same direction, then I think it's more likely that student achievement would be less impacted. And that is one component of our plan.
I just didn't want to lose that train of thought. Thank you. You can continue.
And to your point, I think this next bullet point talks about this.
in 2014, it suggests the cost to develop, hire, and onboard a new principal is $75,000. That was 10 years ago. Everything has increased. The prices have increased of everything. So it's even more now. And so we want to make sure that we are stabilizing our pay so that we are retaining these highly effective principals so that they don't go to central office positions, which is what they're doing right now when they're leaving in droves. So our choice now is to invest in keeping these highly effective school leaders or the pay of equivalent of exactly a year's salary to find and train their replacement. As we look at our final survey question from our colleagues, consider which one is the better return on investment. So again, less than 10% agree or strongly agree that the current pay plan incentivizes principals to want to remain in the position. And we've said this, that many principals who disagree look to transition to those central office positions where their pay is more stable. And you can only imagine when you're trying to have a mortgage or purchase a car that you need some stability in your paycheck in order to have these sort of things. So the only way to move forward in our schools in North Carolina is to retain these strong leaders in our schools.
So we really appreciate your time today and want to kind of summarize by sharing how we believe that we can do better and, again, build on the work that was started. We're not looking to replace the current principal proposal. We're looking to add to it. So the five benefits that would come from the updated proposal is it considers complexity factors that go beyond school size. Schools that have a higher population of multi-language learners or exceptional children or economically disadvantaged students, that would be taken into consideration for principal compensation. We want to use a retention supplement specifically designed to stabilize school leadership and keep principals in the profession of principaling their school, of being a school leader. We want to build a common thread that links teachers to assistant principals to principals, so those salaries provide a progression through an educator's career. And then we want to reduce the dramatic swings in pay caused when maintaining the pay incentives for meeting and exceeding growth expectations. We don't want to remove them. That's not what we're proposing. We're proposing reducing them as part of the updated plan. And lastly, there's a high level of support. I think it's important that at this critical stage, the educators know that they're heard. And so we wanted to make sure that when we were standing before you today, that we had the collective voice of principals from around the state, that we could share a plan that wasn't a major shift from the investment that you made in 2018, but made small changes, but also honored hearing their voices. So now we'll take a closer look at the proposed principal compensation plan. Again, you'll notice a lot of symmetry. It is, I believe, at the bottom of your handout and the current salary schedules at the top part of the handout. Please refer to the handout as we compare the current plan to the proposed plan. Again, first, I want to point out the symmetry between the two, and we want to honor the incredible investment that you guys made. The plan that we're proposing today maintains student growth and school size as important variables to how a principal is compensated, but it reduces the swings between base pay, meeting growth, and exceeding growth. When we look at it, you notice that the far left column is changed to school complexity range. So for example, a student that is economically disadvantaged and has an IEP, that's an EC student that needs a greater level of support, would count more than a student that did not have those complexities in that range. So a student could be weighted so that the complexity range is impacted, and a principal who leads a school that's more complex is compensated. If you notice the jump from base pay to a school meeting growth to a school exceeding growth, that goes from 10% jumps to 5% jumps. We recognize that it's important to incentivize and support principals who lead strong schools that lead to incredible student outcomes. But we wanted to reduce that dramatic swing so that someone did not have an $18,000 swing in their pay, again, based on a maternity leave or an unfilled vacancy, or even, you know, during COVID, there were some principals that, you know, did not have their students in their building, and it impacted the amount of growth that those students had on state assessments, not the year of, because that testing didn't count, but the following year when they returned to face-to-face learning. Then lastly, the bottom part is what Ashley mentioned, the retention stipend. I think this is important, and I wanted to point out that as we developed this plan, we did not ask for there to be a retention stipend for the first 4 years of a principal's career, because that principal hasn't proven to have a positive impact on student learning. But if they're a strong principal and they've been there 5 years, and we want to keep them in the principal role, providing a retention stipend for years 5 through 9, and then increasing it 10 through 14, and then increasing it to keep that principal leading their school, is at the bottom of the revised proposal. So as we bring things to a close, I wanted to share what our request is as a next step. We are requesting that you modify the principal pay plan in 2024 to enhance recruitment, to increase stability in the field, to include school complexity factors, and to recognize experienced school leadership. The plan that we're proposing today continues the work that was started in 2018, and hears the collective voice of principals from around the state to support their work as they support the students in their schools.
As we look at this final step here and this ask of you, we again want to remember that this continues the work from 2018, as John mentioned. It shows that you hear school leaders. It recognizes that schools face different complexity factors. And in our opinion, it prioritizes keeping great principals in the field longer and in their schools. Thank you for your work that you started in 2018. So let's pick up where we left off, strengthen principal compensation in North Carolina. We appreciate your time, and we're happy to answer any more of your questions.
Thank you, John and Ashley. Hang on one sec. We may have a few questions from members of the committee. Representative Shepherd.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I've got a couple of questions and also a statement. First of all, I know many situations in our county when a teacher or someone in administration will retire, and then they'll come back and go back to work for the same school system or the same county. In one situation I know of, a principal retired, came back to work in another school as assistant principal after he retired. Doesn't that hinder someone else from getting an upward mobility promotion? What are your thoughts on those situations? Seems like it would hinder being able to promote somebody else from within.
I agree with you, but I do think each case is unique. And so I think that there are certain parts of the state that it's hard to find an experienced school leader that is battle tested and tried, that can provide outcomes for students. And so there are uniquenesses that boards of education have to consider. But I think if we incentivize the importance of, you know, building that career progression of moving from teacher to assistant principal to principal, where you're impacting a higher, a greater circle of influence, then I think that we can have a more talented candidate pool, so that we can hire an assistant principal and not have to go back to that retired assistant principal.
Follow up,
Representative Shepherd.
Another point that I saw in yours was experience. It's been my experience in our county that when we have a principal that is in a local high school, one, for instance, that's very successful academically, that particular principal had grew up in that community, knew everyone in the community. They knew usually the student's mom and dad and grandparents. And when they were at the local grocery store or something, everybody knew the principal. That school was more successful than a lot of other schools, I think, just because of that principal's experience in being there, and he knew everybody in your family. So he could see them at the supermarket and say, hey, Johnny's not doing so well, you know, that kind of thing. And I think it is very important, the experience. And moving principals sometimes I don't think is necessarily good if they've got a school that they've worked in and they know everyone in the community and they got good reputation with them. My last question is, would this new pay plan keep from having to hold principal salaries harmless from big pay drops in response to, like, Superintendent Truitt did with the COVID money?
Yeah, I'll speak to the first part because that is my story. I was a student at the school that I'm an elementary principal for now. In fact, my daughter goes to school where I went, and she actually had the same classroom that I did, and it does help. But I think what helps more is that you know the community and that you're a good fit for them. And when you are a good fit, you stay there longer to have an impact on your community. Right. This plan does address the hold harmless concern. It does not always fix it. There are always really unique cases, right? And that's what the statute is that prevents a principal from being paid less than one of their colleagues. But it greatly reduces the need in two ways. A, it provides a progression to ensure that the principal is the highest paid educator in the building because their responsibility and their accountability is greater. And so it's recognizing that their pay should be too. But then also the swings are so much smaller. And so if the swing is smaller, it doesn't impact and it doesn't require that hold harmless clause. Yeah, because $18,000, quick math, would be $1,500 a month coming out of a paycheck. Again, sometimes for variables that are beyond the principal's control.
Representative Warren.
It's a unique privilege to speak before Representative Blackwell. So thank you, Mr. Chair.
I didn't know that you cared. I'll have to try to be sure to wait more often.
I always care about your thoughts, Hugh. So a couple questions. The school complexity range, did I miss how you determine or ascertain what the percentage is? How do you derive that? I know what the components were, but I'm just figuring out how you calculate that.
So really, each of these students would count for 1 point in each of these different complexity factors. So if I had a student that was considered a multi-language learner and an exceptional children, they were part of the exceptional children's program, then they would be 2 points. And then you would put all of those points into a bucket, for lack of a better way of describing it, and then that would tier those students in the pay plan. Thank you. Here.
So follow up,
Representative Warren.
So if a student qualified or was determined to be the two categories you mentioned, I think it's gone, I can't see it.
I'm sorry.
But was also homeless, so they would actually be 3 points.
Three, yes.
3 or 4 points. Okay. All right. So another question I have is, we've seen a decrease in student enrollment in the traditional school systems. So this is attributed normally to an increase in homeschooling, an increase in the Opportunity Scholarship Program, tax credits for students with disabilities. That would have, how much of an impact do you think that has had on the current system, which is based on ADM?
Personally, I can speak to this as I was affected by this year. We have a very transient population, and we have, I say, approximately 400. I'm currently sitting at 393 students, excuse me. And I lost about $6,000 in my pay this year because of that. And in New Bern, there's, I think we mentioned it earlier, the affordable housing, the hurricane hit us very, very hard. And so our demographic of students just not able to afford to live in that area. So it has greatly affected us if that's the only complexity factor that we're considering.
And I'd like to add to that. I think the challenge that we sometimes face as public schools is that in the Northeast specifically, you can't really have half a school counselor like the previous presentation. And so when our ADM is impacted, it really makes staffing more difficult in, you know, the rural parts of the state, because it's A, sometimes hard to find a qualified candidate. And then you need one at each school, but you don't quite qualify based on ADM for one at each school, and trying to partner with your sister schools, depending on how your county is geographically. You know, we have a big river running through the middle of Pequimus County that impacts us, our ability to sometimes share positions. So I think that's the biggest challenge, is that when you lose a few students ADM, it may put you under, and it's sometimes not always easy to share positions.
Yeah, final question, Mr.
Follow up, Representative Warren.
So under the proposed pay schedule, ADM doesn't really matter. I mean, you can go from, as in your case, from 400 plus to under 400, and you're not going to shift. Your pay is going to be based on your complexity factor. So you're going to be making, you know, X number of dollars regardless how many students you have in your school. Would that be correct?
School size is still a complexity factor, but it's just one and not the only one that we're considering.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Representative Blackwell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Several questions. One of your slides indicated that 50% of principals leave within 3 years of being hired, and nationally, 1 in 5 leaves each year, North Carolina, 1 in 4. What does the survey or research indicate as to why they're leaving?
The stats that we pulled came from the churn article, which is referenced in this slide. So that could speak more to the specific reasons, but I think it's a variety of reasons. There's the natural attrition of retirement. There's opportunities for successful principals to move to central office opportunities. There are some cases where the principal isn't making a positive impact on student outcomes, and they're not asked to remain in the role. And so I don't know if we could narrow in today to say that this is the specific reason why, but we do know that it's a range. But what we are more concerned about than anything is that number is increasing, you know.
But we don't have any idea what percentage of these would be impacted by their concern about their compensation. We assume it's part of it and that this would address it.
Yeah, the article doesn't speak specifically to that.
Okay. Second question. What does the research suggest the relationship is between the longevity of a principal in a school and the student outcomes in schools? Is there a direct correlation saying that the longer a principal stays a principal, the better his students do than a principal who has not been in the profession, let's say, but 8 years as compared to 14?
Yeah, that's a really good question. I don't know off the top of my head of a longitudinal study that speaks to, you know, tracking a principal with a certain cohort of students throughout, because the only way to do that would be in a K-12 school, right? Because they would keep the same students from the time they came into kindergarten until they graduated. What I would say is that the slide that we shared provides the counterexample. We can't correlate the degree in which the principal staying impacts student achievement up. But what we can say the research clearly indicates is that scores do drop significantly when a principal moves to a new opportunity or leaves education altogether.
And final question, if I can ask this question intelligently, if we were to go to your proposed plan, and if we were to, let's say we were to superimpose that plan on the system for the current year under which you're being paid with the present plan, under the new plan, what percentage of our existing principal population would receive raises?
Yeah, we don't have that exact number. It is something that Dr. Patrick Green and Donna Bledsoe are working on specifically. What we do know is that this would separate principal complexity into tiers, and so a certain percentage of principals would fall in each tier each year, so we wouldn't have, you know, dramatically more principals being paid on the upper end of the salary scale or the bottom end of the salary scale. This would be more of a normal distribution across the different complexity tiers that are outlined. I don't have a percentage for you today of how many are being paid in the current tiers, but that is something that Dr. Patrick Green has been working on with the General Assembly even into last year.
I just comment that my concern, and I'm not opposed to this, and I think bringing in more complexity factors is appropriate, especially if we want to get the most effective principals in the schools where they're most needed and be able to retain them there. But I'm not convinced that the longer you've been a principal means you automatically deserve three times as much as the younger principal who may be a crackerjack and doing a great job, but just hasn't got longevity, nor am I convinced at this point that this model that you're proposing pays enough attention to student outcomes as opposed to factors that really impact the school and what the principal has to deal with. But if our approach is to try to find the principals that are effective, It seems to me it just simply gets you higher pay for having a tough situation, but doesn't necessarily mean you're effective in that role, unless the superintendent, the state board does better. I mean, and the school board is riding herd, maybe more so than I think they are.
Thank you, Representative Blackwell. Also, I've asked Mr. Moore and Fiscal to provide us a rough estimate on a calculation of what this might be as far as dollars. So I'll ask when you get that, send it to Brian, and Brian can distribute it to members of the committee to give us an idea of what a number that will go with this plan. Any additional? I'm sorry, Representative Biggs.
Appreciate you guys and your presentation. I think a study is needed, and I tend to side with you a little bit. I'm not sure if I agree with all the terms and the parameters, but I think you got to have them. Because I know just coming from our two school systems that I have in my district and a former school board member, a lot of times every school is not equal. Challenges are different, homeless situation. If we had a perfect scenario and we put teachers in the classroom, we feel like we're going to get similar outcomes, but we don't. And so what we would do, we'd find it, we'd have more of our challenging areas, and we would have to basically coach or almost beg some of our top principals, hey, will you be willing to take this challenge? Will you be willing to do it? And what you find is we find great people, we find superstars, and sometimes and we've already looked at our growth and our performance grades, sometimes that their grades doesn't show how great they are. Because they're in a challenging situation that if this principal that has this perfect scenario, their school's great, but you don't understand, this guy, he took this school from here to here, it's not there, but or gal, you know, that's the situation. So what we find counties doing is they have to scramble, and at the end of the term when they're paying salaries, they have to go into their own pocket and take money out of their own pocket, because they tell this principal, hey, we're not going to let you lose this money. They go to their school boards, and some school boards are great, and they'll say, okay, you know, we're going to give this extra money, even though growth wouldn't met there, but you took them from here to here, but it just wasn't quite there. It wasn't on the 15-point scale. And so I appreciate the data. We got to look at this, because a lot of principals that are in tough situations are superstars, but they're not getting paid like they're superstars because of the situation they're put in. So I appreciate what you're doing. We need to look at all the parameters and see if we, you know, what we can come to agreement on.
Yeah, that was certainly one of the factors for proposing reducing the swing, right, from 10% between one to the other, and really 20% from base pay to exceeding down to a 5% jump between the two. That exact story is one of the reasons we proposed it. Thank you.
Any additional questions from committee? Seeing none, thank you guys so very, very much for spending some time with us and sharing that most valuable information with us. Thank you so much. All right, members of the committee, before we adjourn, just like to remind you to please, first and foremost, thank each and every one of you for your attentiveness and attendance as we've had this committee meet in the short interim time. The hope is to extend this committee past the short session. We will address that when that time comes. But until then, we have one more meeting, and that is on March the 25th. Chairman Biggs will be chairing that committee, but we desperately need y'all's attendance to pass the report. The report is being put together as we speak, and we're going to send it out in advance to you guys. When? Did we determine? Wednesday the 20th. You should be watching your email for the report, so please go through that report. We'll be having debate, or not debate, we'll be discussing that report on the 25th, and we'll need it to vote it in or vote it out as the committee report. Hopefully, the vote would be in. Questions, Representative Cervania.
Thank you, Chair. I was wondering if we have opportunity to add or edit the recommendations that are being proposed in the...
That would be a point of discussion during the committee report passing.
Very good. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Any additional questions or anyone want to discuss anything about the upcoming report? Having no more business in committee, I'd also like to thank Ian for spending some time with us. Now, Ian, he attends the Youth Legislative Assembly, so he comes here and learns how government is done in this very room right here with about 1,000 of his friends from across the state. So it's, if you ever get a chance to attend that, it's very much worth your time. Come and watch our next generation. It will give you some hope for our future. And with that, the committee is adjourned.
There you have it. That is the House Select Committee on Education Reform, which met today, Monday, March 11th. What's very interesting to me, again, it's unclear exactly why the state does not archive any of these meetings, but what's very, very interesting to me is when you, after the meeting, if you try to watch the video, if you click on it, it opens in another screen and it says, "This is a private video. Please sign in to verify that you may see it." And I've attempted to do that and it basically doesn't let you in. So it's, again, unclear why the powers that be have decided not to archive them. But I do hope this was insightful. Again, and I'll link to those documents in my story that I'm going to do for Cops and Congress, annydance.substack.com. But you can look through them to see those presentations. I think without this context of the audio and the video to describe what you saw in that, it would be very difficult for the average person, even as someone who's highly intelligent or someone who's very attuned to the issue, to decipher exactly what everything means without those additional components. So I try to do stories that really shine a light on issues. So I hope that I've succeeded in that. Please support my work. Thanks for watching.